band have actually carried out in previous years. That's not saliva or slander, it's purely a matter of fact. What I'm really interested in knowing is when everything is changed over, Mark, how are you going to ensure that there is sufficient in the way of clerks, the old clerks of work type thing, or the old civil engineers who used to go around and check properly and positively the quality of the work that's been undertaken? I see there could be a conflict of interest here if we have members of the council officers supervising the work and at the same time being responsible for saying whether it's up to standard or not. Having spent my life in the construction industry, I can see how that could be a problem. So really, just very quickly, Mark, can you give us some confidence that there will be a quality control necessary to overcome some of the alleged shortcomings that have occurred in the past? Because I think that is an important issue. We are trusting these people with a major amount of council taxpayer money to carry out this work, and I wouldn't want to see us going back to the situation where we had lack of control over the quality of work that was being undertaken. Thank you, Chair.
David, we've got an issue because you were raising the question that I was also going to raise, but you couldn't take more evidence than I would. But could I just mention, Mark, that the quite apart from the engineering project, which I'm sure is excellent, there have been some really serious unhappiness about the aesthetic point of it. And I raised some years ago, and I have to say, remembering back to my old youth, I was a county roadman for a while and worked on the tarmac gang. Remember the old gravel greens? Let's go back a bit. But when I look at the aesthetic quality of the edging of the surface dressing on the roads around here, who would have been ashamed of embarrassing or forming by returning work in that quality, where the tarmac road is runs over into the edge of the flats go to where outside of things, that sort of thing. We wouldn't have upset our form, never mind we wouldn't have those engineers. But when I raised that question, I was told that within the price of the contracts that we were bidding for, then that quality of work was unfortunately accepted, but had to be in the price that was value that it was meant. So I'd like to think that if we've got some in-house work being done, and also that we would have a sort of possibly penalty clauses and that sort of thing, I'm echoing some of what David would say.
Okay, thank you, Chair. A number of points. It won't surprise you that when I was present at the Business Scrutiny Committee, I had quite a lot of interesting questions in this vein from members. So, just a few points really. So, in terms of the headline points, also we'll continue to have a performance management framework in place for all of this work, in this area. Even though work will be carried out directly by the council's own resources, it's absolutely the case that we would have an internal service level agreement in place between colleagues that sit in delivery services and those people who are working on that, essentially on that client, either authority side, making sure that work meets the required standards. I think the best way I can properly answer the question is that I sum this up that when we move to the new arrangements, we are taking away a degree of separation that is in place at the moment. So at the moment, if we think about that £4 million a year's worth of planned structural kind of work that we do, so it's many of the same firms are going to be doing that kind of work going forward, and some of those surface treatments and things that we described here. Whereas before, that work was being carried out by those same kind of firms who were subcontracting to Bad Nuttall, who were then accountable to the council. We've obviously taken a link out of the chain, and those firms will be reporting and accountable directly to the council for the work that we do via those seven contracts. So we're going from a subcontractor arrangement with a strategic contractor to a greater degree of control through that arrangement of those seven contracts. And then just briefly, in terms of the reactive day-to-day work, now very clearly we've had lots of talk and political discussions around making sure that we get those services and we get the basic rights and those kinds of things. You know, very clearly that kind of work, there will be an internal service level agreement in place, but it will be people carrying out pothole repairs and repairing street lights, and they will be reporting to the management, the supervisors and the management who are based in delivery services, and ultimately accountable to the man over there is the corporate director. So hopefully that will give members some confidence that there will be a much more, the management of these issues will be much more direct going forward.
Happy David.
Just a very brief comment. Under the previous regime, if the subcontractors hadn't performed properly, Van Nuttall should have been either making them perform properly, or they themselves should have been challenged contractually over the fact that their subcontractor wasn't doing the service properly. Just very briefly, in answer to my first question, all I'm concerned about is that there's some mechanism in place, independent of those who are acting the executive authority, to make sure that what is being done is up to standard and therefore give value for taxpayer money. That, I think I did raise at that last committee you attended, Mark, and I'm just as concerned about it now as I was then. I'd really like to make sure there are arrangements in place, quite specifically in place, to make sure that it just doesn't get left as an open goal. We do need to make sure the quality is right. Thanks, Mark.
To check, we need to make sure we do that.
Nothing else, I think, now we've done that. Have a good day. Thank you very much. Information relating to those audits were recommended actions, including those reports, and outstanding.
table is actually attached to the pending form and identifies at this particular moment in time a number of items which are currently grabbed, rated, and examined. This indicates that actually using hand as roads. One of the items relates to risk management, and there is again an intended item later that identifies the improvements that have been made with regards to risk management for the understanding. Section 3.4 on page 30, identify information relating to the performance of the internal service. Delivery of the other plan is approximately on target for this time of year. Feedback from clients and management remains good, all key actions identified on reports being agreed with clients, and the client satisfaction levels remain consistently high. Section 3.5 on page 30, I identify some of the continuing improvements that have been made to the delivery of the internal service. This is a fairly major feature of the report that is provided merely to demonstrate that the real constant reviewing and challenging what we do, how we do it, when we do it. And the members are asked to note the report before it gets up, which is one item that came out in the minutes, which I wanted to relate to. At the previous meeting, members asked a question relating to HMRC IR35 overall. The question was, how many active placements does the council currently have that sits within this category? I'm advised that there are currently 187 active placements, which are or outside of IR35. I'm advised by HR that engaging staff in this way is still very rare and certainly not a very fair question. Happy to take questions in relation to anything I've informed you
about. Thank you, Chair. Can I just ask more on the survey? Because that was really a concern before this committee, in the previous commitment. I'm happy to see that they are taking some of the actions and they are taking further action. How quickly will you be visible to see where they are in their intensity or further recommendation and without being brought back to the next meeting? Given that this area is a huge amount, huge concern for this community.
The intention is always to undertake follow-up work within the next 6 month period. However, depending upon the nature of the risk presenting, we normally try and escalate down whether there's significant risk associated with the action we've identified. Given the next meeting is September, I'm sure that we can report back. There are only a relatively small number of additional controls that we've implemented, so we'll come back to you in September.
Mark or the response, and I look forward to seeing that before the announcement.
Jeff. Yes, thanks, Chair. A couple of things. First of all, again, in the light of the training we had this afternoon, is it possible going forward in terms of this report? We have the LQ partner arrangements and community arrangements and partner arrangements. I think I did say about training that it would be good to see a map of all those partnerships that we're engaged in, subject that to think about how we manage our assurance around those. So that would be a question for maybe for you to work on that one too. The other thing in terms of rural road committee, I know that in this report you said our risk management is getting better. Notwithstanding, we've got a further review of risk management, which no doubt we will talk about subsequently. And in a way, it's around partnerships and so on. But this, certainly the Rural Growth Company and others, I'm sure, really present the council with quite major risks, actually. And I think, notwithstanding what it says in the further report about the or us being involved in looking at those risks and being engaged, involved in developing those risks, I think there is something there about making sure that we are satisfied as a committee, that those key risks that we've been involved in, concerned around insurance, about value for money, fraud, you know, all those sort of key things are actually covered. So I'm going to look more to that later, but I think that's a real concern for me, based off as this goes through. And the other one, sorry to be thinking wrong, but I think it says we should have done 10 audits, but we've only done 6. Is that right? Am I reading that table? Yeah, I believe. So, is there a reason for that? And what are the plans to bring that back on track? And I suppose, highlighting the fact, I am conscious, so I don't know well whether police are looking at that, where people will ask for audits of each back. So you want a random audit, but the audit might say, well, you know, we're not quite ready for you, can you use a couple of months and do it then? In those, because in other places, people ask to change the plan and data, that's a good indicator of itself. Having some process that highlights the fact that this particular, the people due to be audited are asking to be back, and normally a place where that decision gets signed off. So I suppose my question is, have people been asking for audits to be reprogrammed? Or is it an issue about resources, or is it just an issue about something else that can't think of right now? And following that up, do we have a process by which we would approach you to perform the plan? What's the decision-making process about whether that would happen?
I'll deal with the last question first, if I mind. In terms of the loads completed, there's nothing sinister in that. What we've scheduled to sort of take 10 line and completed 6. What needs to work, and I've come to a conclusion since I was support. So the timing and in terms of the message that I'm trying to convey, I'm not sure. It looks like a lot. You've got to bear in mind that these reports have been produced kind of 3-4 weeks before the date of the meeting, and there's always a lot of work in train, and sometimes it comes to first of problems. I'm not troubled in the slightest with that. No, I'm not, because I'm aware that in the interim one, you'll see from the bi-monthly report, which it should be in the CTOM sometime back end next week, the full list of those 10 months. So I'm providing really short in the other way. There isn't a resourcing issue there. In terms of clients approaching us to delay orders on them, it's extremely rare, to be honest with you, because we don't plan them out of pre-planned and scheduled. So,
which includes the chair, the team, and I think the council more generally of the workers' committee from my direction are to be congratulated for the fact that so many recommendations that have been found on that even closed out. I can remember a time we need to get a whole list and no one seemed to be overly interested. So I think that's something we chair of the authority should be. And the only final point on those is we talk about training for children's services will be included with them. This was your grievances on. Will be included with a programme of personal development to be rolled out by December 2017. Given the whole culture, it can be argued that grievances are difficult, but they can actually be an indication of a culture of bullying culture and so on. So, could you give us some sort of assurance now that it was rolled out to all staff by December 2017? That was the action that should be done by.
Can I just refer back to a comment you made earlier on the board of people being some back to yourself in relation to the target work that we're going to take there. At the moment we are putting through a project four, so it's kind of ongoing by guidance in relation to the trouble that's going to
be absolutely.
However, yeah, I'm sure that we can include something within the end of the day that gives you a bit more detail if you like in terms of the definition where we're focusing attention on what kind of in terms of the outstanding items related to the grievances and the training, you might recall a previous meeting with the HR and provided quite detailed feedback in relation to that specific issue. We haven't yet been back to follow on that, so I can't tell you today. However, it will be on schedule. Significantly informed my overall opinion. the outcome of the audit involved in the key financial systems. You'll note that the table includes section 337 on pages 57 and 58. None of these systems have been assessed as presenting a major organizational risk in the joint review. The full breakdown of the opinions provided in the audit reports is included on page 63 and 74. This section also includes an explanation to the risk opinion provided in the 93 audit reports produced during the year, with assignments based upon the likelihood of issues carrying a range from negligible to serious negligence. The analysis included, whilst indicating similarity to last year's, it does identify a slight increase in the number of audits identifying as major and moderate population risk. Reflecting the current challenging nature of the public sector landscape. The modest nature of these increases does not provide any cause for concern, and more than compensated for by the number of orders that they find the next door reflecting our effectiveness or strong environments. The vast majority of the opinions provided remain within the minor and negligible opinions, suggesting that there remains an awareness amongst officers and managers to be very robust systems of development. Section 4 of the report, further analysis identified, including breaking out those reports produced by organizations this opinion. Those reports identified major organizational risk opinions in the year are identified in section 424 on page 69, and they include comments identifying what actions were taken by senior managements in the year to address reported issues. In each of these cases,